here, and I will continue with some very experimental physics, not theoretical. But still, we have a strong interest in the Lorentz invariance, and I will try to show you why. Where is the arrow? Ah, yes. Okay. So I will speak of a new experiment which has been recently approved at CERN and which is totally devoted to the measurement of the gravitation with antimatter. And as you understand quite easily, any deviation from the standard gravitation for antimatter will be a hint for Lorentz invariance, of course, for violation of the Lorentz invariance. So the motivation effectively that we are doing with that a direct test of the equivalence principle, but with antimatter, means that there has been a lot of tests of this equivalence principle with matter, and no direct test for the moment with antimatter. And to check if the inertial mass and gravitational mass for antimatter are still are the same as with matter at the level of the present experiments. Second point, I would say, is that even if we find that it is exactly the same, it is a new experiment because this measurement has never been done. So it's a textbook experiment in the sense, even if we find that there is no deviation. And the other interest of that, is, and I will show a few words about it, is that a matter-antimatter asymmetry has strong implication in terms of cosmology and effectively for dark matter, dark energy, and so on. And we know that there is a dark energy, dark matter, and that general relativity does not account it very easily for the moment. And maybe antimatter could be a way to look at this problem. So I will go back to the first theoretical developments about anti-gravity. It means abnormal gravity for antimatter. I would trace it up to the work of Scherk in the 70s, 80s. And at this time, it appears that a new force, a fifth force, was claimed by some revision of the Eötvös experiment with matter. And one way to account for new gravity was to add some new field, gravi-scalar and gravi-vector, which naturally gives rise to anti-gravitation. We resumed here, where you have two new field, vector and scalar, which add effectively to the Newton law. And in this case, we see that with the matter, we test only the combination B minus E. And with antimatter, we will check the B plus E. And it means that for anti-gravity, there is a negative component in this kind of model. Of course, this kind of model was done with for very short range modification of Newton law. And the field were massive, so it was a short range, but you can extend it with a null mass fit to large range. And there was also some work with torsion induced axial vector, and still axial vector interaction could lead to P and then the CPT violation. So the conclusion of this kind of development was clearly set by, if I remember, it was John Ellis who told that in the 80s, that saying that experimental evidence was very conclusive, that there existed a fifth force, but there existed also a sixth force, and both cancelled exactly. It was the conclusion of this time. So it's not a subject of research now, but still, the idea to add some new fields will giving some different gravitation for antimatter is still there. And there have been several developments also from about what means a negative mass. It means, in fact, it's a mass with negative active gravity. And also, introduction Lorentz on CPT violation is standard model extension. That's Kostelecki and Tasson, essentially. And which Womet's model where there are some new fields which makes new parameters in the theory. And you have an effective inertial mass and an effective gravitational mass. And both are equal for matter. But for antimatter, there is a factor which has a negative sign. And so for antimatter, the equivalence is no more the case. So another prospect for antimatter and anti-gravitation is also a cosmological implication as was studied by Gabriel Chardin and his student Benoît Lévy, who is presently at the IAP here. And they explored the cosmological implication of a Dirac-Milne universe, which is essentially based on symmetry between matter and antimatter, negatively active gravitational mass, and they deduce that such a flat space-time has a negative curvature and has a linear evolution of the scale factor, which makes that in this case the horizon has no more problem. You have no inflation needed in the theory. They make a calculation for the accelerated expansion, and we see there that both lambda CDM and Dirac-Milne universe have the same behavior at a large redshift. And so they also found that it's compatible with nucleosynthesis and with the first peak of the CMB and so on. So that's a work which is not completely finished because there are a lot of calculations to do. Presently, they are not working on it as far as I know. But I think it's interesting to see that different kind of gravitation could have very important cosmological implications. So going to experiments now, there is a good discussion of experimental constraints in Nieto and Goldman physics reports, which is quite a good paper for that. There exists some indirect tests, I mean experimental. And essentially, about the antimatter content of the matter, which is Schiff argument, where you say that there are virtual pair of A plus or minus, so antimatter, anti-electrons into the atoms. You could add, you could look at some violation of the weak equivalence principle and give some constraint of the exact content of the antimatter inside matter. That has been largely studied and scrutinized. No, it has been criticized also because most of the conclusion depends on the normalization procedure, in fact. But of course, it's interesting to see that. The K0, K0 bar system also is a good way to study to make an indirect test. That was done by the CPLIR collaboration. So that was in the 19. And also measuring the cyclotron frequency of proton and diproton in the same magnetic field allows also to make a constraint on the gravity for antimatter compared to the gravity of the matter inside due to the frequency change it could happen for that. That's for the experimental constraint. For the indirect one, for the direct experimental constraints, I would say there is almost nothing. Okay. If you want to make a direct test, either you do that on antimatter, charged antimatter, and in this case you have a problem of electromagnetic shielding, and the systematics are much above any measurement you can do. So it has been tried but never gave any results because of systematics. Neutral antimatter is only the only way to look at that. We can refer to the discussion of the neutrino arrival time of the supernova of 1987A, because on the bunch of neutrinos which have been observed, there is a large probability that one of them is a neutrino and not antineutrino, so you can deduce from the same arrival time of all constraint of the on the gravity on antimatter. But clearly, the new experiment to do that will use anti-hydrogen, which start to be produced routinely, I would say, at CERN, but with a rather complicated experiment. And that's the goal of the JBAR experiment, to look at the free fall of an anti-hydrogen. So the principle is very simple. You create an anti-hydrogen, and you let it fall, and you know the starting time of the fall and the end time, and that's all. That's the most easy way to... most easy thing to say, but there are very, very big problems for that. The problem is that you have to cool in order to have a vertical initial velocity, which is zero. And if you want to cool that, you have to go to a level of temperature or energy or speed, which has never been attained for the moment. For example, in this case, if one wants a detector of reasonable size, we want to have velocity below the 1 meter per second, which means temperature, equivalent temperature of the cooling for the anti-hydrogen of the microkelvin, of a few tens or hundred of microkelvins. But the record temperature attained up to now for either antiproton or anti-hydrogen, by the ATRAP collaboration, for example, it's something like 5 orders of magnitude above. So how to cool down, that was a real problem, how to cool down anti-hydrogen, because direct cooling is not a technique which can work. So the idea comes from Walsh and Hensch, is to go through the anti-hydrogen ions, HBAR plus. So a proton with two positrons. And in this case, if you can produce these ions, you can cool it with sympathetic cooling, which is a technique which has been done with antimatter, up to temperature of the order of 10 microkelvin. So you just have to send a laser to detach the extra positrons. You have the starting time of the fall, and you measure the annihilation of the fall of the anti-hydrogen after the fall, and you have a time of fall, and you know the heights, and you can have the gravitation constant for the anti-hydrogen. Of course, if it goes up, you couldn't do the same. You measure also the timing, see where the anti-hydrogen annihilated. And with a few hundred of such events, you could reach a precision of the percent. But the second problem is how to produce HBAR plus, which is not easy. That has never been done. So there is a way to produce it, which is through two reactions on positronium, the state bond. A plus, A minus. So if you manage to make a big cloud of orthopositronium, which is the state with a longer lifetime, 140 nanoseconds, you send antiproton beam inside the cloud, and you have two reactions possible, and you can produce HBAR plus. So you need a very high density positronium cloud which implies that you should start with a very intense also positron beam. And you can increase the reaction with excitation of the positronium. So the G-bar implementation, I will show the synoptic just after that, means a lot of different apparatus to go to this point. There is, of course, antiproton, so that will be done at the LNR ring, which is a new ring being built at CERN and with the antiproton decelerator. After the antiproton decelerator, we need a high positron source that will be obtained with a small LINAC giving high energy, high intensity electron pulse and producing a high intensity positron beam. We need several traps for trapping the positron to accumulate them, for trapping the anti-hydrogen ionized H-bar plus and to cool them. We need a reaction chamber to make the interaction between proton, antiproton and positronium, to produce positronium and make the interaction. We need transport from QCX, several laser systems for all that, and the final detector. And with that, we can expect for each LNR burst something like a fraction of event. It means one event every 2, 3, 4, or 5 pulse. So the synoptic scheme is, as I said, so a LINAC for the positron, which are trapped, LNR, which gives the antiproton, which have to decelerate. They interact in a reaction chamber with a laser exciting the positronium. The antihydrogen goes up. The ions goes to a trap where they are captured. They are cooled with the laser. A laser get rid of the extra positron, and then we detect the four. So the status is that this experiment has been recommended recently at CERN. The collaboration is now well established and start to increase it anyway. We have developed already a prototype, a demonstrator for the positron source at Saclay. We have a pinning trap which has been transported from the Riken laboratory in Tokyo to Saclay for the adaptation to the trapping of the positrons. And there are just presently a lot of development. I will not go too much in detail on that. Collaboration with French laboratories, European laboratories, and world laboratories, and especially at Mainz and LKB, the best specialist on cooling of ions. Just a short picture of the installation we have at Saclay presently, which consists of a LINAC, a chamber where we produce the positrons, a separator which selects the positrons, a tube for the beam, transporting the positron. For the moment, we are at this level here, and this month we are building the last part of the line in this one. And that's the trap, the positron trap, pinning trap which comes from Riken. And we have presently a rate. We demonstrated that such an apparatus can have a rate of positron which is already at the level of the best or above the best standard radioactive source, and we have to go up a little bit further. And for the final detection, so I think I will, just go to the last point, which is that we are approved, or we are recommended, and the final approval depends on the discussion of financial discussion, but that's a detail. So we plan to start the installation at CERN in 2014, and to be ready with the start of the new LNR ring in 2016, and result in 2017, and at this time, I think we should have an unambiguous value on G bar, the gravitation for antimatter, and theoretically, if their predictions are okay.
Quick question.
You mentioned that antihydrogen has been trapped already successfully.
Oh yes.
The question is: Have anyone done already the spectroscopy with it? Like any transitions?
Okay. Yes and no. Yes, it has been trapped. It was already the first trapping was in 2010. Last year, they show alpha shows that they trapped it for more than 1,000 seconds. And presently, they are running. And we know that there is a paper under embargo in Nature for the first measurement ever done on the level of the antihydrogen. But it's not yet, it should be those weeks, I don't know when. Next Nature or issue, or I don't know, they will publish the first measurement.
Is it hyperfine?
Hyperfine, yes. They have measured. We understood that they have measured the hyperfine, but it's normally an embargo. I don't know the detail of it. Only big chiefs at CERN have been in the confidence, but that's the alpha result, the result of the alpha. So if you want to know more about it, you just invite Jeff Hengst to make a seminar. He will tell you about that.
Okay. Other brief questions, comments? If not, let's thank the speaker again.